talk to you about the Belfer measles and cephalopods. So this is a bit more of what I think is the Belfer measles and cephalopods. But first, some conceptual clarity. It's been remarkably difficult to define welfare. There's a lot of discussion about that, but I think we all can agree about that welfare has something to do about the quality of life, but the individual experience. So, welfare, the verb welfare, is the same as the verb farewell, as a good journey. So what we are concerned about is, do the animals have a good or bad life journey, or journey through their lives? So that's why people are worried about welfare of animals also, that they don't want to be, that they shall suffer or have pain or have a happy life. So health and performance is, of course, related to welfare, but this is about how well the organism functions and performs. Closer. So this is also relevant for plants or any organism. So welfare, the experience of quality of life, that's something that happens in the brain. It's conscious feelings of emotions, and that is created by the brain, body, and every body, because everything is interconnected, so we can't put the brain alone. So, but this gives quality to sensory experiences and monitoring of needs, motivation to fulfill our needs, and also gives the ability to know what is good and is bad, and to learn. So the main criticism against this definition of this physical feeling-based definition of welfare is that feelings cannot be observed. So that's maybe relevant for fish that is not so expressive as cephalopods. But even fish can tell us a lot. But cephalopods, you have a fantastic organism with a large behavior and lot of semiotic freedom, and they can show a lot of signs, and they have almost unlimited range of behaviors because of their unlimited body that can take all kinds of shapes. And I think that this is not possible to have this enormous range of behavior without some kind of consciousness. So I also talked about this, our picture that you saw yesterday about this homunculus, or wider pelvis, representation of the different parts of the body in the brain. So you see that the hand is very large, and also the lips and mouth. Face. So there was an interesting book some years ago from Frank Wilson about the hand, or the, what's it called, the cultural history of the hand. The theory that it's the hand that developed the brain, not the opposite. So most people think that the body is made for carrying the brain around, but it's actually the opposite. The brain is there to carry the body around. When we look at cephalopods, they have this, we have only two hands and rather stiff and still sensitive hands, but they made us available, possible to manipulate things and sense things and do things as cephalopods. In addition, the cephalopods, like this giant squid, not squid, but let's call it cuttlefish, had a gigabyte TV screen on his back that can signal everything. So this, I think that this is the reason why they are so intelligent, not that they are chased by fish, because everyone is chased by fish. But to have this body made a creative or intelligent animal. So back to welfare. So if we agree about that welfare is the integrated quality of life experience by the animal. So and also welfare is about this life journey, so it's about this kind of sum of the aversive and rewarding experiences during time. So when I'm concerned about welfare, we're concerned about some, at least some period that we keep the animals or their life or whatever. The well-being is more at the moment, but the quality of life is now. So needs, what is needs? Or what do I mean by needs? So every organism organism had to survive and grow and reproduce in this and survive is the first thing they had to do. But then they had to get enough nutritious food, avoid predation or injuries or disease. Learn the difference between good and bad and find and create the best and safe environment. And also become an attractive partner again. Not all needs. So welfare needs is how the animal itself are perceived, these needs or how these requirements are perceived by the animals or monitored by the animal's emotional system. Say for example, if you need food, you are hungry and you have a need for food. So this is a citation from Mark Brockley that helped us to develop this welfare assessment system in the Netherlands. That the welfare state of the animal is more or less by definition is strongly correlated to the states of its biological needs. So the more the states of need deviate from fulfillment, the worse is its welfare. So the more starved you are, the more poorer are your welfare, for example. So we have appetitive and aversive needs or resources to be obtained, like food and living condition and partners, and dangers to be avoided or aversive needs. We need to avoid predators, harmful organisms, and harmful environmental conditions. So this is a kind of list of needs that is taken from, say, any organism anyway. But I try to look at all these needs are fulfilled or can mean to are relevant for a cephalopod. So I also take this definition in the beginning here, that welfare indicates the indicators. What I mean by that is observable, measurable, and scalable attributes of the animal or its environment that are correlated with the focal animal's experienced welfare. So, and state of need. So this can be observation of the animals or the resources or like temperature or oxygen. And operation, that we mean that this is something we can measure on the animals where we study them. So, the needs are not fulfilled, the welfare is bad, and when it's fulfilled, it's good. And the welfare indicators need to be correlated with this. So, if we measure that the fish is fed and not recognized, then we think at least that the need for nutrition is fulfilled. So back to the cephalopods. So one welfare need that's in opposing is very important for animals is safety and protection. So not to avoid to be eaten or attacked. So associated feelings are fear and alertness, arousal, safety and maybe relief. I don't know if cephalopods feel relief, but they're safe from a predator. But welfare indicators can be like their, especially their behaviors and not so much about their color or that color pattern and all their behaviors. They're fearful. I don't know if anyone has studied fear in cephalopods, but at least this guy maybe feels safe in this coconut. So we can also measure physiological stress indicators like the fish, catecholamines, and cortisol, etc. Body integrity is kind of overlapping with the other ones, but this is more to protect its body from injury. So that's very important for everyone for the animal to be intact, not wounded. So there is like pain, suffering, well-being is kind of feelings that make the animal learn to avoid or protect its body integrity. So the indicators are like bones and different all kinds of health indicators and also physiological measurements here. Feeding and nutrition is of course important. And here feelings like hunger, starvation, satiation, and all this liking, taste, smell, and aversion for food to learn what is good and bad food and when they need to eat and everything like that. So here is also behavior relevant to horses, like if they are interested in it, also like body condition and various health and function indicators related to nutrition. And also just the quality of food is involved, yeah. If it has good quality, you can at least know that the animals have good nutrition. So then, it's a quick turn. Respiration is in need of oxygen and it's rid of the carbon dioxide. So this is an example from Valverde and Garcia, a paper from 2005, where they measured the what you call the gill frequency, or this call it encephalopods. Yeah, the movements of the breathing frequency, the oxygen saturation. And they show that dogs are around 60%, they have the same breathing frequency. And then it increased a little bit, oxygen dropped, and until it could not breathe anymore or take up oxygen anymore, then it dropped. So I guess that the well-being of the animal will be start to be quite bad here in the end. Like we are driving and cannot breathe anymore, a lot of pain and panic. But also the old hair, it may be a transition area where the well-being is not that good. We start to feel that this is bad conditions. So this kind of study, I think I have also a paper here that showed the oxygen consumption of the animals. You see they can keep up their oxygen consumption up down to around 30%, and then they drop. So this is where the animal starts to die. So this kind of study is going to be used to find where the limits or different levels can be. And where the limits for good and bad. Good and bad answer can be. In addition, we can look at the behavior of the animal, if it's panic, if change color, if anything like that, frequency and skin patterns. Also, it was measured the oxygen, as we know, have the information about this in behind. So the exploration, searching, or the urge to get new information, that's very important for animals to find, know their environment and know where to find food and know where the predators are and where the cells are, etc. So this is like curiosity and anticipation and surprise, frustration, boredom. So this is this need or this behavior is a very good indicator of positive effort. If these animals are explorative, it's a sign that it's sick or stressed or and pain, etc. So, rest and sleep, that's also very important because an animal can be active all the time. And I don't know so much about sleeping in cephalopods, but the point is that they are sleeping more like humans. So, at least they a lot of the time in their beds, they're probably relaxing enough. But of course, the hair can also study their behavior and what happens if they are sleep deprived, or what that strength will do with their physiology or other behavior. Social contact, most of the cephalopods are loners, but you have the squid that are schooling, that they must have final attachment or positive experience by staying together. And also probably are stressed if they stay alone. I don't know. The fish are, schooling fish, if you put them alone, they are very, really stressed. And often die. Sexual behavior is related to a lot of poor and good welfare for most animals. to the humans. So, and I guess the octopus, they have this dangerous way of having sex, so that they're risking cannibalism and being bitten out of the arm or something. So I think there must be some welfare-related factors going on here, but it's usually not what we are concerned about in animal welfare studies. So, so the challenge we have on there is to try to assess animal welfare is how shall we put all these pieces together, all this information. So, then I think it's necessary to do what we call overall welfare assessment, to make a science-based evaluation of the welfare of selected group of animals using a set of welfare indicators with the intention to covering all the animals' welfare needs. So to look at are the needs fulfilled or what do the indicators of these fulfillmental needs tell us and put it together. And some are more important than others. That's something I've tried to do in Sepsis in Action, in Working Group 4. We make a database where we try to collect all this information about this welfare relevant observations of octopus, sepia, and squid. So, I don't have time to go through this now, but this is explained in the web pages from Sepsis in Action. So what we have done is we made a software that we made earlier for salmon. So there we fill in all the welfare relevant statements for these different needs. So for these three species. So then we go through a lot of literature and find what is relevant, say it's like this paper from Oxygen and write well art is the need of respiration to fit in this species, and then also get a long list of references. So at the moment we have reviewed 122 papers and there are about 400 better statements in there. So what we hoped would happen is if we get more interested people to help us with reviewing literature and adding in welfare relevant statements in this database. So we in the end could end up with an overall welfare database that is based on science. So you don't see this, but this is just a list of statements of within the keyword oxygen. All the information about the octopus, how much oxygen they need, and statements related to that. So what we end up with that, so for example, this welfare indicators related to oxygen, is that you can find scientific statements where the level is fine, or the welfare should be good for the animal, then where it's moderate, where it's bad, and where it's threatening or death threatening. And so this can be used up to evaluate welfare. So this is for salmon. We have put together these individual based indicators. So and they are also weighted according to how important we think they are or relevant to welfare. And you can make a kind of forms that you can put in all the relevant information and this data of this program analyze it in the end. So we get kind of overall welfare indicators for the here is for different sea cages in different parts of Norway. So the one is the maximum or the best welfare, and this is put together of both the cage environment based indicators and group indicators and individual fish indicators. So And you can also look at the individual indicators, areas like the emaciation or user fish indicator, where all this is distributed in the cages. So you see that down below there, you can see that some cages are quite poor welfare according to this indicator. Okay, you find more on this web page, and you can also participate if you want. And join us building up this database for cephalopods. So this database can also be used if you want to write a paper about oxygen needs in cephalopods or temperature, whatever, and list all the statements and references that are relevant for this study. So it's so if you could join together to do this, it would have been very good. Okay, thank you.